Hi, my name is Michael Seidman. I am an otorhinolaryngologist head and neck surgeon, also known as an ear, nose, and throat surgeon. I received my Bachelor of Science degree in nutrition and a medical degree both from the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor. I did my residency training in otolaryngology and then a fellowship in hearing, balance, facial nerve, skull base, acoustic neuroma, and cochlear implant surgery at the Ear Research Foundation in Florida. Vertigo is a term that describes a sensation of motion. Often people who suffer with vertigo tell me that they are dizzy. Dizziness can also refer to such feelings as lightheadedness, unsteadiness, wooziness, confusion, giddiness, a sensation of being pulled, a sensation of walking on a waterbed, a floating sensation, a feeling of being on a boat, or just getting off a roller coaster. The list goes on and on. Typically, describing the sensation that my patients are experiencing is very difficult for most people with balance problems to do. Balance problems are very common, with more than 40% of patients over the age of 75 experiencing such problems. Actually, 7 million visits are paid to doctors each year for the symptom of dizziness or vertigo. And more than 70% of patients with true vertigo have an inner ear source for their balance problem, which is why it's so hard to get in to see us sometimes. The feeling of imbalance without a turning or a spinning sensation is not usually due to an inner ear problem. And there are literally thousands of causes for balance disturbances, many of which have nothing to do with your ears or your brain. Neurootologists, which is what I am, are otolaryngologists, head and neck surgeons who have a particular interest in hearing and balance disorders and have taken a fellowship beyond residency to study these types of problems. I'd like you to take a look at this picture of the ear here, and you can see how complex it is. Now, the ear is made up into three places. There is the external ear, the middle ear, and the inner ear. The external ear starts from the outside of the ear called the helix. It includes the external auditory canal, and it goes up to the eardrum. In the external auditory canal is where wax is, for example. If you have a blockage here, it can be irritating and can also cause some hearing loss. Now, the middle ear starts on the inside surface of the eardrum, and it consists of the three of the smallest bones in our body called the malleus, the incus, and the stapes, also called the hammer, the anvil, and the stirrup. It is an air-containing space that connects to the back of the nose via the eustachian tube. Now, if you look at the smallest bone of hearing, the stapes bone, it's the smallest bone in our body, right at that point on the inside surface of that starts the inner ear. And the inner ear consists of two major components, the vestibular component, which is responsible for balance. It has three semicircular canals, a saccule, and a utricle. And also the cochlea, which is the snail shell-shaped organ responsible for hearing. And then both of these are connected to nerves or via nerves into the brain. And you can see that the nerves to balance from the vestibular system are here, as well as the nerve for the cochlea or the hearing nerve and the facial nerve all sit inside this little tiny internal auditory canal. And right here is where small tumors called acoustic neuromas, for example, can grow. Now, this picture, as you can see, is very complicated, and there's a lot going on inside the inner ear. And with this, now that you have an understanding of problems that can occur inside here, a complex interaction of the inner ear coupled with two other sensory systems maintains our balance. So we have the three semicircular canals in the left ear and three semicircular canals in the right. The somatosensory system, which means the brain, the spinal cord, muscles, and joints, and the visual system. One way to understand this is to think of the three systems as legs of a tripod, just like this: the inner ear, the central nervous system, and the visual system. These three systems are all necessary to maintain proper balance, and disorders of any of these can cause balance problems. Interestingly, we know that people can function relatively well with two of the three systems, but when you develop a problem in one of the remaining two systems, serious balance problems occur. For example, people who have had diabetes for years may develop an inability to feel the floor with their feet. This is a somatosensory problem. By day, they may have little trouble maintaining their balance. However, if they get up in the middle of the night when it's dark to use a restroom, they often find that they are very unsteady. What has happened is that normally they are living with two of the three legs of that tripod intact, namely the inner ear and the vestibular system, as well as the vision. Since the somatosensory component is not functioning well because of the diabetes, when you turn out the lights, you remove the second of the three systems or the legs of the tripod necessary for good balance, thus leaving only the vestibular system, and therefore the balance is off. Even people with severe back or neck problems, such as arthritis, can have problems with their balance, again having nothing to do with the inner ear. One very important aspect in trying to sort out the causes of balance problems includes finding if there are any ear symptoms. Specifically, I am interested in whether there is any unexplained hearing loss, fluctuation to your hearing, does it affect one or both ears? Is there any fullness, blockage, or pressure sensations in the ear that is not related to allergic problems, being on an airplane or being in the mountains? Is there any ringing, also called tinnitus, buzzing or roaring in the ears? Typically, all patients and all people have experienced these symptoms to some degree, but the primary concern is if there is any relationship to the balance problems. It is also important for us to know if there are any specific neurologic symptoms. What I mean by a neurologic symptom is something that points to the brain, or a brain cause rather than an ear cause. For example, is there any history of loss of consciousness, confusion, unexplained headaches, migraine symptoms, changes in your vision, weakness or numbness of part of your body, just to name a few. Your past medical history is also very important to me. Knowing whether there are any preceding bacterial or viral illnesses is important, such as the flu or the common cold, for example. These infections can actually localize to the inner ear and potentially cause balance or hearing problems. Other common causes of balance disturbance is head trauma, such as hitting your head in a car accident, falling off of a ladder. There are also many chronic diseases that can cause disequilibrium, such as diabetes, low blood sugar or high blood sugar, severe allergy disorders, thyroid abnormalities, cardiac disease, heart disease, and blood pressure alterations, both high and low, smoking and alcohol use. Medications are probably one of the most common causes of balance problems, and there are more than 5,000 medications listed that can cause imbalance. So you should consult your pharmacist or your primary care physician regarding these medications that may be causing dizziness. Before your consultation with me or one of my colleagues, it is helpful and highly recommended that you have had an extensive evaluation by your primary medical care doctor. This will help rule out other possible causes of balance disorders. It is important that they give particular attention to the cardiac or heart and the neurologic or brain systems. It is also helpful if they have done a metabolic evaluation. That might include such things as blood sugar testing, blood pressure, electrolytes, which are chemicals in your body, sometimes a thyroid test, sometimes not. And there are many other studies that may or may not need to be done. After you have had an extensive evaluation by your primary medical doctor, you will have an evaluation by me or one of my associates. This includes a complete otolaryngologic head and neck examination and a directed neuro-otologic examination that will include tests of your cranial nerves. These are nerves that let you smile, close your eyes tight, move your tongue, shrug your shoulders, the list goes on. I will also test eye movements and balance testing, such as walking a straight line or stepping tests. Other objective tests that may be done are a comprehensive hearing test that takes about 30 minutes. I may also recommend an auditory brainstem response test, but not that often. And this is a test where they put small electrodes on your head, they put clicking inside your ear, and it looks specifically at the hearing nerve. And it tells us if there's any kinds of problems with that hearing nerve. That takes about an hour to do. There is also specific balance testing that I may need to do, such as an ENG, that stands for electronystagmography. What they do is they put the same kind of electrodes that I just described on your head, they have you follow some lights on the wall, they put some cold and warm water in your ears. Most people tolerate this very well and don't get too dizzy, but it can make you a little bit off balance when they do that. And that test takes about an hour and a half. And what that lets us do is to know whether it's the right ear that's involved or the left ear that's involved. So it does allow us to localize. It can also tell us if there are some brain problems. Another test that you might have is called the rotational chair test. The rotational chair test is when you sit in a chair and they actually rotate the chair back and forth to the left or to the right. You're in a dark booth and you have the same electrodes on your head. Now, what they can tell us with this is whether the brain is involved or whether the inner ear is involved, but it can't tell us right or left ear. On rare occasion, I shouldn't say rare occasion, occasionally I may also perform a test called platform posturography. Now, platform posturography is a test where you stand on a platform and we are able to manipulate your visual field, and the somatosensory system. So we can actually mess with those types of things, and we can isolate each of those three legs of the tripod on its own. And I primarily do this for people who have disequilibrium or imbalance problems. So most of my patients don't have to go through this. If you have true vertigo, I'm probably not going to ask you to go through the platform posturography test. There's another test called an electrocochleography. This is a test that I rarely do, but it essentially helps us to know whether you might have increased pressure inside your inner ear. Now, this is not your middle ear or your external ear, but your inner ear, as you recall. And this test is something that people who work with a lot of patients with Meniere's disease, as I do, some say it's very helpful, some say it's not, and I occasionally will do this type of test. These tests that I have discussed help us in the localization of your particular problem and can possibly affect the treatment recommendations that I give you. Often after completing this extensive evaluation, we may still not be able to learn the source of your balance problem, and I may recommend either a CAT scan or an MRI. Now, these are types of scans that we use. The CAT scan uses radiation, so you're actually exposed to radiation. It doesn't give us as good of a picture as an MRI, and typically for these problems, I am recommending an MRI, which stands for magnetic resonance imaging. Now, magnetic resonance imaging is a long tube. You go inside this. There's a fairly loud noise. Some machines are a clicking, pop, 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 pop sound that's very loud. They will give you earplugs, and if you go to a place that doesn't give them to you, I would recommend that you bring them with you just to protect your ears. They will usually start an IV and give you a contrast agent called gadolinium. If you're allergic to CAT scan dyes, you are almost never allergic to the MRI dye, but you need to tell the doctor who is doing these types of things. Now, for some of you, the MRI may be claustrophobic inducing. And for patients of mine who have that problem, if you would tell me, I can prescribe some Valium for you beforehand, but you'll need a driver to bring you home. The MRI gives us a beautiful picture inside the brain and inside the inner ear. From time to time, it may be indicated for me to send you to a neurologist for further evaluation. Once we have ruled out potential dangerous causes of balance disturbances, we can talk about treatment options that may exist. I would like to talk to you about some of the common treatable balance disorders. One of the most common balance problems that we see is called benign paroxysmal positional vertigo, or BPV. BPV is characterized by position-provoked sensation of vertigo. Most patients will tell me that if they roll to the left or they roll to the right in bed, or if they look up on a top shelf, sometimes called top shelf dizziness, or if they turn their head rapidly or bend over rapidly and spring back up, that they become very dizzy for short periods of time. What we see is short-lived spells of true vertigo. The room is spinning for about 15 to 60 seconds. The most common cause of this problem is from either head trauma or infection, but usually it's unknown. This is a self-limited problem, which basically means that if you do nothing, over time this will go away. Often it can come back at a later date just to haunt you a bit. In the olden days, doctors would recommend a cervical spine collar to limit any position that would make you dizzy. Today we have been recommending something called Cawthorn exercises, or a particle repositioning maneuver. Another very common problem is Meniere's disease. In the late 1800s, Prosper Meniere recognized a disorder characterized by four symptoms. Number one is true spells of vertigo. Two is fluctuating hearing loss. Three is oral or ear fullness or pressure. And four is roaring tinnitus or tinnitus. The problem is caused by a buildup of inner ear fluid called endolymph. And sometimes this disease is called endolymphatic high drops. The exact cause for this buildup of fluid is unknown, but it is thought to be because either too much fluid is made or too little absorption is occurring in the endolymphatic sac. The diagnosis of Meniere's disease is a clinical one. That is, the diagnosis is made from the history we obtain from you, from what you tell me. There are some classic findings with objective tests, namely a low-frequency hearing loss, one of the reasons that audiograms are very important. Balance testing, such as the ENG, may range from normal to abnormal. It is helpful if we find a weakness in one of the inner ears on the ENG, but this is not always the case. Sometimes a CAT scan or an MRI scan may be indicated to rule out other problems. Patients having Meniere's disease typically tell us that their ear becomes full or blocked. Then they get a roaring sound in the ear, and then the hearing seems to go out. This is followed by severe vertigo. The spinning sensation usually lasts from as short as about 15 minutes up to 12 hours, but the average patient tells me about 1 to 3 hours. Following the attack, the symptoms resolve and patients often feel normal. Some patients will still feel off for a day or so. The primary treatment options are to restrict your salt, caffeine, alcohol, fatty foods, and simple sugars. This serves to reduce the overall fluid volume in your body and thus reduce the endolymph that we had talked about. Oftentimes, I will prescribe a diuretic, that is a water pill, and that serves to reduce the overall amount of fluid in your body and also in the inner ear. Typically, I'll prescribe diazide, one pill per day. Another common problem resulting in balance disorders is vestibular neuronitis. This is characterized by severe vertigo with nausea and usually vomiting. The spinning usually lasts for 1 to 3 days with gradual improvement over the next several weeks to months. Interestingly, there is no associated hearing loss or other symptoms because this affects only the vestibular portion, not the cochlear. The lack of other ear symptoms is what differentiates this problem from labyrinthitis, which affects both the vestibular system and the cochlea and causes hearing loss in association with the dizziness. Labyrinthitis usually causes vertigo and imbalance for 3 to 7 days with a slower recovery. Both problems, the vestibular neuronitis and the labyrinthitis, are initially treated with medications such as Antivert or Meclizine, same thing, Dramamine, Scopalamine, and Valium. This helps make the symptoms more tolerable. If there is associated hearing loss, we will often give a trial of steroids to see if any of the hearing will come back. The most common causes of vestibular neuronitis and labyrinthitis are viral causes or bacterial infections that may occur anywhere in the body and then possibly spread to the inner ear. Reduction of blood supply to the inner ear may also be a cause of the mentioned symptoms. And we often never find out the true cause unless we take out your inner ears and look at them underneath the microscope, which most people will not want us to do. Another option in the treatment for dizziness is vestibular rehabilitation. Specifically, we give you exercises designed to strengthen the balance system. We also encourage general exercises provided your medical doctor has cleared you from a health standpoint. Exercises do not help immediately. They take time, possibly as short as 6 weeks, but usually many months. Performing the exercise program twice daily is typically recommended for up to about a half an hour each time. Over time, the dizziness usually subsides. On rare occasions, some people may continue to have episodic spells of vertigo. If the hearing is good, a vestibular neurectomy may help. This is where I cut the actual vestibular nerve. If the hearing is poor, then a labyrinthectomy may be indicated. Some patients complain of persistent lightheadedness and wooziness, which are not likely to be improved with surgery and may even become worse. Another cause of dizziness is something called a perilymphatic fistula, or PLF, which is the result of an abnormal communication between the inner ear and the middle ear spaces. The most common cause of a fistula is from a surgical procedure called stapedotomy that I do for purposes of conductive hearing losses. Other causes are head trauma, pressure changes caused by scuba diving is fairly common, weightlifting if you're doing it wrong where you're pushing hard, and that's why professional trainers tell you to make sure you breathe out as you're lifting, very important, and rarely airplane travel. A lot of times people can have pressure in their ear, but that's not going to usually cause a problem in this regard, but it can. The symptoms can be diverse, but may very well be similar to Meniere's disease. In 1988, I was asked to present a paper to the International Symposium of Meniere's Disease in Harvard, in Boston, on perilymphatic fistula and how it may mimic Meniere's disease. The symptoms usually are hearing loss, tinnitus, fullness, and vertigo, very much like Meniere's disease. Although many of the standard audiologic hearing testing and balance tests will usually be performed, the only true way to diagnose a PLF is through an exploration of your middle ear. And whether a fistula is identified or not at the time of surgery, I will patch both the oval and the round windows, which are the two primary sites for the leak of fluid. This patching is done whether the leak is present or not, as a microscopic leak can be present that I cannot be seen or it can be intermittent. There are hundreds of other possible causes for balance disorder. There is an entity called vascular loop. This is where a loop of blood vessels pulses on the hearing and balance nerve inside the brain. On rare occasion, vascular loops may cause hearing loss, vertigo, and tinnitus. This problem can occasionally be diagnosed with an MRI scan, but sometimes requires an angiogram. The primary problem that I have with this is that more than 75% of all people have a vessel loop that is very close to the hearing and balance nerve, yet they do not have any balance problems. One of the things that we would do with this is we'd actually go inside the brain and put a piece of Teflon, it's called the Ginetta procedure, in between the vessel and the loop. So it's not something that we do very commonly, but it is something that we can do if we make that diagnosis. When we age, there is also a reduction of blood supply to many parts of our bodies. Sometimes we can document the reduction of flow to the brain with ultrasound studies, carotid or vertebral studies, or other blood flow studies such as an MRA, which is magnetic resonance angiogram, or routine angiograms. When there is a reduction of flow to the vessels in the back of the neck and the head, this is often called vertebrobasilar insufficiency. Sometimes these studies are not diagnostic or helpful, and I may often begin treatment with medications such as aspirin is very good because it thins the blood, Presantine does something similar. Trentel is a drug which actually causes the red blood cells to be more malleable and slip through the blood vessel better. Or cyclospasmol, which is now pretty difficult to get a hold of. All of these medications improve blood flow by one of several different mechanisms. They all have the potential side effect of stomach irritation, so I want to make sure that you take them with meals. Another cause is something called migraine. Migraine was first described by Hippocrates 25 centuries ago. It is a common disorder and it can occasion cause balance problems. There is also an entity called cervical vertigo where patients have severe neck problems, and this alone can cause balance problems. This is a very difficult problem to prove as a cause, and often it is a diagnosis of exclusion. There are many other causes for balance disturbances. The most common, besides medication, is metabolic, and usually high blood sugar or hypoglycemia, which is low blood sugar. Other associated laboratory disturbances would be high cholesterol, which is a big problem, high lipids or fats, low or high thyroid, the drugs, the medications we had talked about, as well as allergies may cause some balance problems for some people. As you can see from this detailed discussion, there are many causes of balance disorders. Some are easy to sort out, while other causes are quite elusive. Few things in life are as frustrating as a chronic or a long-term balance problem, whether it is constant or episodic. Many people feel as though they have lost control over essential body functions. Some cannot drive or do routine activities of daily living. Some have experienced fatigue or problems concentrating. Some people begin to feel anxious or depressed and wonder if they are going crazy, pardon the expression. These emotional responses are normal reactions to a chronic balance problem or any other kind of chronic problem. It is important that you realize that emotional stress or any kind of stress makes this or any medical problem worse. But it is also important for many people to realize that this emotional stress is indeed a normal response, and for some this makes the overall problem a bit easier to deal with. Fortunately for most people with dizziness, the problem is not a serious one, but it is a nuisance that must be coped with from time to time. It is important to realize that sometimes a specific diagnosis can be made for dizziness, and other times, we cannot. Often it is difficult to explain your problem to your friends and family because they cannot see your actual problem. In these instances, psychological counseling is often helpful in dealing with these aspects of the problem. I would like to tell you that I understand that it is a very difficult problem for you. I am eager to help. Having said this, you must also realize that even after a detailed history, a detailed examination, and appropriate testing, we often cannot tell you what exactly is wrong. So as physicians and healthcare providers, it is frustrating for me to not be able to tell you absolutely what's wrong. Likewise, I know it's very frustrating for you. Out of 100 patients with dizziness, after a careful search, we can come up with a diagnosis in about 50 or 60% of those patients. The other 40 to 50%, we often shrug our shoulders, apologize, and tell you simply, we don't know why you have this problem. This has been probably one of the major impetuses for me to learn about non-Western medical options. What I mean by this is complementary and alternative medicine, which I abbreviate through the rest of this talk as CAM. We must realize that medicine as you and I understand it does not have all the answers. We need to learn from our colleagues in Asia, Germany, Pakistan, and India, for example. With this in mind, and with my Bachelor of Science degree in nutrition, and the fact that I have studied herbs since 1981, I very much think of alternative options. So I have several chiropractors, acupuncturists, people who do St. John's neuromuscular therapy, and herbalists that I work with. I have had many patients achieve improvement when traditional medicine or medical ways have failed. To me, this is a teamwork approach. I want to make sure first that you do not have anything dangerous going on. I then want to find out, if possible, what you have and then treat you appropriately. Several alternative options include chiropractic medicine where they manipulate the spine and the neck. acupuncture, they put small needles inside you, and they stimulate those needles, and they work along meridians or planes. St. John's neuromuscular therapy is a treatment that sort of argues a bit against chiropractic, and what they believe is that a chiropractor can adjust your spine and put it back in, but the muscles in your body are constantly pulling them back out. So a St. John's neuromuscular therapist actually works to move the muscles and realign the muscles, and then they say that the spine will follow. It's a very intriguing methodology, and they've had wonderful success with migraine, headaches, and other chronic disorders, and I've had some of my patients have improvement with their balance problems. Also, massage therapy, general massage therapy, and herbal therapy, and there are many other options that can be used. I'd like to talk to you about some specific nutrients that may be beneficial for vertigo problems or dizziness. As you can see from the list, there are many things here, such as magnesium, which can come from grain, nuts, beans, and greens and vegetables, calcium, potassium, lipoflavonoids is an interesting one and has been used, also B vitamins, multivitamin supplements are also available. Also, there are many herbs that can be helpful to treat vertigo, and this is a list of them, such as ginkgo biloba, which has been shown to improve circulation, Alzheimer's, cognition, tinnitus, and vertigo. You have to be careful if you're on an anticoagulant, such as heparin or Coumadin. And rarely you can have GI upset, but that's particularly with the off-brands. The primary dosing that I typically recommend is 240 milligrams twice a day, but the bottle usually says 40 to 60 milligrams. The German Commission E clearly says that 240 milligrams twice a day is very much appropriate for patients with balance problems or ringing in the ear when we're talking about ginkgo. Ginseng is another excellent herb. It has been shown to be beneficial for fatigue, depression, stress, general well-being, sexual energy, and digestion. It is important to avoid it if you have high blood pressure or diabetes, and these are relative contraindications, as well as pregnancy. High doses can cause insomnia, anxiety, and stomach upset. You also do not want to use these with anticoagulants like heparin or Coumadin, for example. The dosage is typically 100 to 300 milligrams, 1 to 3 times per day. Blessed thistle is another herb, and the standard dosage is about 2 to 3 dropperfuls, 2 to 3 times per day, or up to 4 to 6 grams per day. I'd like to talk to you about hawthorn. Hawthorn is actually something that's very good for the heart. It's beneficial for atherosclerosis, which is hardening of the arteries, heart arrhythmias, abnormal rhythms, high blood pressure. It actually improves the cardiac output, which means the output of the heart and coronary or heart blood flow. There are no contraindications, so you can pretty much use it with anything, although you should not use it if you're taking digoxin, digitalis, same type of drug. It can be mildly sedative, and there are no specific interactions with the exception of the digitalis, and also foxglove is an herb that digitalis is made from. The standard dosage is about 160 to 900 milligrams per day. Gotu Kola is another important herb which is very good for memory and hypothyroidism, but it's also good for people with some balance problems. The standard dosage is about 50 to 600 milligrams per day. Cocculus compositum, also called Vertigo Heal, it has these primary ingredients: Cocculus indicus, Conium maculatum, which is actually poison hemlock, ambergrisia, which is a portion of whale liver, and petroleum. This is a homeopathic remedy that actually activates vestibular regulatory systems and the brainstem. There was a double-blinded, placebo-controlled study to show it being as effective as CERC, which is a drug that's used in Canada, and both of them were significantly better than placebo. There are no contraindications, meaning you can use it without any problems, and there's no adverse reactions. Normally, they'll tell you do not use for more than 10 days if you have a balance problem without the permission from your doctor, but I always recommend it, and people have been on it for years and years without any problems. Another new thing that I had found recently as I was asked to write an article for the Laryngoscope is a compound called Divertigo. This is a combination of 7 highly concentrated oils. What you do is you put a few drops, you rub it behind each ear, and they claim that 80% of the people using the product have resolution of their vertigo. So if anybody is interested, it's relatively inexpensive, on the order of $15 to $20 for a bottle. These are things that are not really well tested, and so I'm putting them out there for you to consider. Other alternatives for vertigo would include such things as acupuncture or acupressure, moxibustion, that's where they put needles in and actually light the needles at the end on fire, sort of, osteopathic adjustments or chiropractic manipulation, as we've talked about, St. John's neuromuscular therapy, meditation and relaxation therapy, and either some people feel that magnets may be of some benefit as well. Either myself or one of my colleagues will be in to talk with you to answer any additional questions or concerns that you may have. Additionally, we have this text written down for you so that you can review it at your leisure or refer back to. Also, I am here to help you to the best of my ability, and I look forward to working with you. Thank you so much for taking the time to watch this video, and have a great day.